Good morning, everybody, and a blessed Christmas to all of you. Welcome to GCC gathering today, whether you are here physically or on Zoom. Hopefully you can see us on Zoom, yeah? My name is Sue, and I'm a covenant partner here at GCC. And just to let you know, later we're going to have a few people coming up, and if you see them on stage without a mask, they have taken the antigen test and have tested negative. So just for your comfort and knowledge. Okay, so today's service will be slightly different as we wish to use this opportunity to have more singing and sharing to celebrate Christmas. And therefore, we will have songs interspersed with sharing by different people. And in between, we will celebrate the Lord's Supper together, spend time confessing our sin, and listen to a devotion entitled Solus Christus, In Christ Alone. So let me read to you our call of worship today. Taken from Philippians 2, 5 to 7. Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. Jesus did not approach the incarnation asking, "What's in it for me? What do I get out of it?" In coming to earth, he said, "I don't matter." Jesus, you're going to be laid in a manger. It doesn't matter. Jesus, you will have nowhere to lay your head. It doesn't matter. Jesus, you will be an outcast and a stranger. It doesn't matter. Jesus, they will nail you to a cross and your followers will all desert you. And Jesus said, "That's okay." This is what he means. He made himself nothing, taking on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of man. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for coming to earth so you could redeem us. When we think of the extent to which you were willing to go in order to save us, it makes us want to celebrate and to cry with thankfulness. Without you, we would still be lost and in sin. But because of everything you have done for us today, we are free. Jesus is our Lord, heaven is our home, and Satan has no right to control us. We will be eternally thankful to you for everything you did to save us. Amen. I'll invite the worship team now.
Morning, everybody. Merry Christmas to everyone. And want to invite all of you to stand as we sing together. We can sing Christmas carols together. My name is Joel. I'm a covenant partner here. So let's start with singing Christmas carols, Angels We Have Heard on High. Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo, is Deo. Shepherds, shepherds, why this jubilee? Why your joyous strains prolong? What the gladsome tidings be which inspire your heavenly song? Gloria in excelsis Deo, Gloria angels.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly, sweetly through the night. And the mountains in reply, echoing their brief delight. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Come to Bethlehem and see Him whose birth the angels sing. Come adore on bended knee Christ the Lord, the newborn
church family. Merry Christmas. My name is Naomi and I'm going to be sharing how Christ's presence has been a blessing this past year. So his presence has been a blessing this past year through how I've been growing closer in a relationship with him in my devotions. When I read my Bible in the morning, he reveals so many things to me in the scripture, so much of him. When I through these unprecedented times, I have seen how he is sovereign and kind and never changing. He reveals so many things to me in the scripture, so much of him.
He has shown that I need him, that he is the Messiah. In this time that I spend with him, he is changing me and my desires from glorifying myself to glorifying him. He has reminded me in my devotions each day that his grace is amazing and wonderful, and even though I don't deserve it, he still loves me. I cling to the cross where he has saved me and has redeemed me as his. His presence this past year has been a blessing and a comfort, and I am so thankful that I have been able to have such good devotion time with him.
Will you stand and sing with us? Let's sing Jesus, Thank You. Give thanks to him for his salvation, and also give him thanks for this year.
Of Calvary,
you the perfect Holy One,
you the perfect Holy One, crushed your Son to drink the bitter cup reserved for me. Your blood has washed away my sin, Jesus. Thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you. Sacrifice, I've been brought near. Your enemy, you've made your friend. Pouring out the riches of your glorious grace, your mercy and your kindness know no
washed away my sin, Jesus, thank you.
You can be seated. This year has been one of both joy and grief. From the finality of my parents' divorce and continued realities of COVID to our precious little girl joining our family, there is great comfort in knowing that Christ is present in both. One of the passages that has brought great comfort to me this year is Psalm 139. The first half of the psalm says this: O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain it. Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. If I'm truly honest, it can be easy for me to forget that Christ's presence is always with me. I tend to want to take control, to do the next thing that is urgent. And I lose sight of the fact that he is walking with me through his people and his church, through my individual time and communion with him. He is present when I am sharing the good news of the gospel with a student in my classroom, but he is also present with me when I am changing a diaper. This Christmas season has been one of sweet reminders to slow down, that Emmanuel, God with us, is not just a promise for the Christmas season. It wasn't just true when he was on earth. It's true today. As we look forward to a new year, it's hard to predict what it will hold. But what I do know is that the Lord will be there. He will be with me in the times of laughter and in the times of sorrow. I cannot depart from his presence. And that brings great joy and comfort to my soul.
Would you stand and sing with us?
Come, all you unfaithful, come, weak and unstable, come. No, you are not alone.
Oh, come, barren and waiting ones, weary of praying, come, see what your God.
Christ is born. Christ is born. Christ is born for you. Oh, come, bitter and broken, come with fears unspoken. Of his perfect love. Oh, come, guilty and hiding ones, there is no need to run. See what your God has done. Christ is born.
Save for our power. Morning, church, and Merry Christmas. I am Maureen, and I'm a covenant partner here in Gospel City Church. One of the short people here, so they are struggling to get it right. Right, I'll be reading the catechism question, and it will be lovely if everyone would answer the answer is up there with me, and then I'll go into a moment of silence, and then do a prayer. Right, the catechism question, that's the last one for this year, is what hope does everlasting life hold for us together? It reminds us that this present fallen world is not all there is. Soon we'll live with forever in the new city, in the new heaven and in the new earth, where we will be fully and forever freed from all sin and will inhabit renewed resurrection bodies in a renewed, restored creation. Let's take a moment of silence and think about what Christmas is. And what we have made it of and for. Think how we have displeased our Father in ignoring him. Thank you. Almighty God, most holy and gracious Father, we are gathered here today to celebrate Christmas and worship you with words and songs of praise. We praise you for your love and your providence for us when you fulfilled your promise to rescue us by the birth, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus, for humbling yourself to come in human form, so that we may rejoice of the day when God became man, to be Emmanuel, God with us. However, unlike our Lord Jesus, we still hang on to our pride, our self-satisfied independence, our own accomplishments, and continue to focus too much on the things of this world. Forgive us, Father, as we repent here our guilt and our forgetfulness of you. As we celebrate your birthday with much merriment of food and drinks, trees and presents, parties and lights, help us remember and reflect that it all began with you and it's all about you. Jesus, you alone are the well of everlasting living waters, the vine that always sustained us, and the light of the world that lead us out of the darkness. Heavenly Father, have mercy on us and guide us along the path that you have purposed for us. Heavenly Father, we bring before you today also the flood victims in Malaysia. May they receive the help they need. May their homes be restored and keep them safe from further harm. We plead, Holy Father, that the government, the rescue teams, as well as friends and neighbors, in fact, all of us, may rally caringly to their side in these dire times. Help us care. Help us serve in this broken world. Finally, Father, we pray that while we await the fullness of your kingdom, we shall face the trials of this life in the sure hope of everlasting life through Christ alone. In Jesus' name we pray.
Morning, friends. My name is Gary, and I'm a covenant partner of GCC. And today, I'd like to just share a short reflection of how Christ has been a blessing to me. The past 2 years have been rough, from lockdowns and restrictions to loved ones who suffered from terminal illnesses. A very close member of mine was diagnosed for advanced stage cancer when the first MCO hit. He suffered through the whole process of surgical removal and radiotherapy. And he's still having the side effects from the radiation. I was devastated and I'm still coping with all that is happening. But oftentimes God showed his extraordinary grace to me. And most of the time through ordinary means, like through his words, his people and his spirit. God says in his word in Romans chapter 10, verse 17, that faith or trust in God comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. During the lockdown, my wife and I had a very good bonding session with our three boys. Although it could be a little bit chaotic sometimes, but we managed. I remember teaching them about the children's catechism questions, like who made the world? In which they replied, God. And what else did God make? Everything. And where is God? Everywhere. And can you see God? No, but he always sees me. As simple as it seems, this was the simple truth of the word of Christ derived from the Bible. I was kind of encouraged because despite all that is happening, I was reminded that God always sees me through. He has taught me to trust in him and his guidance despite the circumstances. In 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 3 says, "Blessed be the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. The hope that there will be no more pain and suffering, nor sin and death, is found in the hope that we can have in Christ, who took upon himself the punishment of our sins and brought us forgiveness as well as new life."
I'm going to invite all of you to stand and sing with us. Alone, who took on flesh, food.
oneness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied.
Hello? Hello? All right. Good morning, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Adam, and I'm a covenant partner here at GCC. And so for those new here today, GCC has been going through a five-part series on the five solas of the Protestant Reformation. And previously, we've gone through Soli Deo Gloria, meaning glory to God alone, Sola Scriptura, meaning scripture alone, Sola Fide, meaning faith alone, and Sola Gratia, meaning grace alone. And today marks the final part of our series, where we will merge a message on the last sola, Solus Christus, meaning Christ alone, with a Christmas message. But before we start, let's pray. Father God, I pray that you'll bless this time as we learn from your word, and I pray that Jesus will be the center of it all. Open our eyes to see and ears to hear the glory of the gospel. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So if you have your Bibles, please turn with me now to Acts chapter 4, verse 11 to 12, and then we'll get started. All right, so Acts chapter 4, verse 11 to 12. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. So this will be used as our launching verse for this week, and then we'll explore more of God's word later. So today, I'll only be spending time on two points,
instead of the typical three, and they'll be number one, the world's biggest problem, and number two, the world's only solution. Yeah, so world's greatest problem. So a few weeks ago, I was at an interview for a scholarship I was applying for, and one of the questions I was asked was, what is society's biggest problem? I think it's quite an apt question for today's message. So I'd like to ask you the very same question. What do you think is society's biggest problem? For the interviewers, they were probably expecting an answer about world politics or economics, like access to healthcare or climate change. However, as I thought more about it, I came to the realization that for a problem to truly be the biggest problem, it would have to first satisfy two criteria. Firstly, the problem would have to be universal, meaning for it to be society's biggest problem, it has to affect the whole of humanity. So if you said poverty, then it really wouldn't be our society's biggest problem, for the plain reason that it doesn't affect everyone. None of us in this room may be billionaires, but I think at least most of us in this room are in good enough financial standing that we don't need to worry about affording dinner later tonight, about going back to warm bed when we sleep later. And secondly, the problem would have to be inescapable, meaning not only does it have to affect everyone, but it also has to be so bad a problem that nobody on earth can do anything to fix it. So if you said our biggest problem is hate, well, that can be easily solved. We can just stop being hateful. If you say it's war, corruption, natural disasters, lack of education, pollution, whatever it may be, I can guarantee you that in one way or another, it's either solvable or not everyone is affected by it. So is there anything that actually fulfills this criteria? Well, what have I told you? That the Bible actually warns us that we have a far greater problem that surpasses all others, that is both universal and inescapable, and above all, our problem is against God himself. The Bible calls this problem sin. Maybe you're thinking to yourself, how can sin be our biggest problem? How is that both universal and inescapable? And didn't you just say that hate isn't our biggest problem because we can just stop being hateful? Why can't we just apply the same logic and say that sin isn't our biggest problem because we can just stop being sinful? Well, you'd be right, but only if sin meant just doing bad things. If sin meant just doing bad things, we can just stop doing bad things. And then voila, you know, our biggest problem is gone. But let's see what the Bible has to say. So in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 3, Paul says, "And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind." So the Bible describes sin as something that we can be dead in. It's not referring to a physical death, but spiritual death. You see, sin isn't just merely doing bad things. It's also a nature and condition that we have. Doesn't this passage just show us how inescapable the problem of sin is? When someone is dead, you can't just go, "Okay, bro, just wake up only lah, just alive only lah." You know, you can't do that, right? People think you're crazy. So in the same way, no matter what you do or refrain from doing, you cannot get out of spiritual death. Dead people stay dead unless there's a resuscitator, just like how sinful people stay sinful unless there's a savior. But that still leaves us to the next part. Who does sin affect? Just Hitler? Just Stalin? Just the corrupt? Just the racist? Just the sexist? Verse 3 in Ephesians carries on to say, "Among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind." In case you're wondering, the reason why Paul is using the past tense, like once lived and were, is because in this particular letter, he was addressing a church. And so if you're sitting here today and haven't heard or accepted the gospel, you could very well still be who Paul is describing in this passage. living in the passions of your flesh, carrying out the desires of your body and mind, and by nature, a children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. If you haven't yet put your faith in Jesus, maybe you're thinking, how can I say such a thing? How can I be so judgmental that I believe that anyone who doesn't share the same view as me are all these things in the passage above, while I can pretend that I'm holy and I'm sinless? Read the passage again. The universality of the problem of sin could not be made clearer. We all live in the passions of our flesh, carrying out desires of the body and the mind, and are by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. Christians have no right to pretend that our actions or good deeds make us any less sinful than those who aren't. In fact, it is because Christians understand the nature of sin that we'll be the first to admit we are sinful people in the first place. I forgot where I saw this quote, but it goes something like this. A church is the hospital for sinners, not a museum for saints. So now we've seen from the Bible that we have a problem that far surpasses any other. That's inescapable because it's in our nature, universal because it affects everyone, and worst of all, goes against a holy God. And I'll do you one better. If you thought of all the problems you listed originally when I first asked you what society's biggest problem is, they're actually all just symptoms of the greatest problem we have. Think about it. God says, love your neighbor, but we have problems like hatred, racism, sexism, that's sin. God says, you shall not steal. We have pickpocketing, we have corruption, we have fraud, sin again. Even natural disasters like earthquakes, tsunamis, hurricanes, these were only post-Genesis 3 events. Meaning in God's initial good design of the world, all these things hadn't existed yet. It was only after Adam and Eve sinned that the whole world had fallen and destroyed God's original design. So even in uncontrollable events such as cancer or all the natural disasters you can possibly think of, they are all actually still rooted in our original sin problem. Therefore, not only is sin the greatest problem of all because it's inescapable and universal, but if you were to collect all the other problems you can think of, those problems are still your sin problem. That's how great the problem is. If this is your first time hearing something like this, you're probably going to have a lot of questions, right? How can a loving God allow this to happen? As much as I'd like to answer your question, I won't have time to fit it into this message. So don't worry if you have any questions. It's only natural since it shows that you're thinking. You can ask any covenant partner here at GCC after the service, and I'm sure we'll all be happy to take your questions. But moving on. So we know sin is a problem we have, but for it to be cemented as our biggest problem, it must also have infinitely bad consequences. Just because something is universal and inescapable doesn't automatically make it a problem. For example, a beating heart is inescapable because we'd be dead without it, and universal because everyone has it, but we don't call it a problem. So then since the problem needs a consequence, and for it to be the biggest problem, then it needs an infinitely bad consequence, what are the consequences of sin? Natural disasters lead to death and destruction. Tyranny and oppression leads to chaos. What does sin lead to? First, we need to understand what we are doing when we sin. Not only is sin part of human nature, but also is a willful rejection of God. Acts 4, verse 11. This Jesus is a stone that was rejected by you. And when we reject God, meaning we believe we know better than him, whether in our speech, thoughts, or actions, and carry on doing what we know we ought not to do, we become what Ephesians 2, verse 1 to 3 describe. Sons of disobedience and children of wrath. We will meet God's wrath. Because God is holy, he cannot tolerate sin. So what does he do with it? He eternally separates himself from it. So if we continue to refuse God, we'll be separating ourselves eternally from the God of love, mercy, and grace. And if we are eternally separated from the God of love, mercy, and grace, there will be no love. There will be no mercy, and there will be no grace. This is an infinitely and eternally bad consequence. But now, here's what we celebrate. In our lifetime, we may never see the end of poverty, we may never see the end of corruption, we may never see the end of natural disasters. In fact, all of these problems may never be solved in this world. However, the Bible tells us that the greatest problem we face, sin, has been solved for us. Let's move to the second point, the world's only solution. If the problem of sin is inescapable because it's something we are dead in and dead people cannot resuscitate themselves, the only way to solve our problem is to have a savior. A resuscitator who isn't dead, meaning our savior, must be sinless. And for this savior to have the ability to save the whole world from their problem, this savior also must be infinitely powerful. And for this savior to desire to save us from our problem, this savior must also be merciful. The Bible tells us of only one such savior, Jesus Christ. Colossians 1, verse 15 to 20 says this about Jesus. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Nobody else is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. It is by nobody else that all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. In nobody else were all things created through and for them. Nobody else is before all things, and in nobody else are all things held together. Nobody else is preeminent. Nobody else but Christ and Christ alone. And because it's Christ alone, there's nothing else that can save us. Not our own good deeds, not any politician, not any scientist, but Christ and him alone. And since it's him alone, then all you need to do today is to put your faith in him, and that alone will solve your problem. This does not mean, however, that all your other problems will vanish. You will still suffer, just like Christ suffered on this earth. But we can suffer with a smile on our face, knowing that firstly, suffering is temporary. Secondly, God is sovereign over it. And thirdly, that we are now in perfect fellowship with God. How does he save? Verse 20 in Colossians 1 says, by making peace by the blood of his cross. Whether you're a Christian or you're not, you've probably heard it before, Jesus died for you. But let me say it again. Jesus died for you. He lived a sinless life that we couldn't, died a death that we deserve, all this so we can have a relationship with God. So whatever sin you've already done, currently struggling with, or will do in the future, will be scratched clean off your record so that now we can draw close to the God of all love, all mercy, and all grace. That's why we celebrate at Christmas. And so the most important question today is, who do you say Jesus is? If everyone has this problem of sin, which creates a divide between us and God, and a man who claims to be our savior lands on this earth, we must answer this question. Who do you say Jesus is? The question, who do you say Jesus is not something random I came up with. It's the very same question that Jesus asked his disciples. In Mark chapter 8, Jesus asked his disciples, who do people say I am? His disciples replied, people think you're John the Baptist. Others say Elijah, and others say you're a prophet. Jesus then replies and asks, who do you say I am? And Peter says, you are the Christ. Jesus then goes on to confirm that he is the Christ by explaining that he, the Son of Man, must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed. And after three days, rise again. Jesus lays his life plan out very clear. For most of us, our life plan will go something like, you know, get a degree, then get a job, then start a family, and then retire. Jesus' life plan is that he'll suffer, be rejected, die, and then rise again 3 days later. And only if Jesus is who he claims to be, then is our greatest problem solved. So the question today is, who do you say Jesus is? His claims are so profound that he leaves us with only three options. As C.S. Lewis puts it, Jesus is either a liar, a lunatic, or Lord. First, if he claims to be the Christ and the Son of Man, which if you read Daniel 7, is a claim to divinity, but he knows he isn't, then Jesus is a liar. But second, if Jesus genuinely believes that he is the Christ and the Son of Man, but isn't, he is a lunatic. But if he is neither of these, then Jesus is Lord. We Christians believe that Jesus is Lord. And Romans 10 verse 9 says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And for this reason, we are sitting here today in remembrance of the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ, the only one who can save. So, in conclusion, what do we celebrate on Christmas? Cookies, presents, times with the family? Oh yes, but more importantly, we celebrate that 2,000 years ago, a baby was born in a manger whose name is Jesus. He lived a perfect life, grew up to be a man, and died on a criminal's cross to save the people who rejected him from the consequence of their own sin. For those who've been with us throughout the whole Solas series, we celebrate that society's biggest problem has been solved by faith alone, through grace alone, in Christ alone, according to Scripture alone, all for God's glory alone. We rejoice that society's biggest problem has been solved even though we didn't do anything to deserve it. Not by obedient behavior, not by attending church or Bible study, but by wholly resting on the object of our faith, Jesus Christ. Why? Because Acts 4 verse 11 to 12 says, this Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there's salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Let's close in prayer. Thank you, God, for giving us the time and space to come and worship you this morning. Thank you for sending your Son Jesus to die in our place so that we can stand blameless in your sight. And I pray for those here in this room today that have yet to accept you, will you, by your Holy Spirit, convict them of their sin, open their eyes to see that all of humanity has a problem, repent and put their faith in you and you alone for salvation. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Hi, good morning, church. Merry Christmas. My name is Massimo, and I'm one of the elders here in Gospel City Church. And now we come to a time where we take of the bread and of the cup. The Lord's Supper is a symbolic act of obedience, whereby members of the church, through partaking of the bread and the fruit of the vine, memorialize the death of the Redeemer and anticipate his second coming. Now, later on, right after this, all of us will go out and we will share a meal together. This meal right now, this bread and this cup, is only for baptized believers. Now, what does it mean to be a baptized believer? And why is it only for baptized believers? Well, a baptized believer is somebody who put their faith in Jesus and then has publicly signified that through baptism. And why is this only for baptized believers? Because as we said, read just now, this is memorializing the death of Jesus. So by taking the bread and the cup, you affirm that this is my belief. I believe that Jesus came 2,000 years ago. I believe that he is the Son of God. I believe that he died on the cross for me and resurrected again after 3 days. So if that is your faith, if you are a baptized believer, we invite you to partake in this Lord's Supper with us. If you have not put your faith in Jesus, we ask you to kindly refrain from taking the elements and take some time to maybe think through the question that Adam just asked us. Who do you think Jesus is? So as I will shortly break the bread and take the cup, I will ask all those who would like to partake of this meal to stand up. And then we will have ushers come out and they will distribute to you the elements. And then as you have received the bread and the cup, you may be seated again. And then we'll partake together as a family of the bread and the cup as well. On the night before Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he said, this is my, he broke it and he said, this is my body broken for you. In the same manner, he took the cup and he said, "This is a sign of the new covenant, my blood shed for you." May I now ask the ushers to come forward and help distribute the elements. So if you can, whoever wants to partake, please rise and we will pass you the cup and the bread. Now, in Gospel City Church, every week we take a different look. And today, as we take a look, we look back. We look back 2,000 years ago when Jesus came. We celebrate that He is God with us. That even though we were sinful, God so loved us that He sent His Son to die for us. So we celebrate both His coming, and we also celebrate, well, that He came to die and rise again. But as Adam just shared with us, it's very important for us to, as we look back, recognize who is He, who is Jesus. So with that, let us read together, as we look back, these verses from Colossians. Let's read together. And He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything He might be preeminent. For in Him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through Him to reconcile all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of His cross. And you, who were once alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, He has now reconciled in His body of flesh by His death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before Him. If indeed you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel that we preach. If you have received your elements, you may be seated so that we will know who has received and who is still required. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before You this Christmas and we thank You. We thank You that You chose to come and pursue us. And as You saw us sinful, You came to redeem us. And Father, we thank You that You did shed Your body, that You did send Your Son to shed His body and shed His blood. Father, we thank You for the cross. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. I mean now, invite the worship team to come back up and the announcements as well. Oh, first, okay, invite Joshua to come up and share. Thank you.
All right, so good morning, everyone. I'm Joshua, and I'll be here to share what God has done, how have I seen Christ present in my life over the past year. So reflecting back on this year, and as I was preparing this testimony, I could see how Christ's presence has been a blessing for me through three words that I would sum up, which is providence, protection, and progress. So for the first point, providence, so a little bit more than a year ago, we went through the equip group for a praying life, this book by Paul Miller, together as a church. So this has taught me how to pray, even when I think I already know how to pray. And one of the main takeaway for me from this study is to come to God just as we are, which is be honest in our prayer. So at the time I was looking for a job, not because my company was downsizing that I got fired or what, but I was just too stressful at my old place and I just wanted to change a new environment. So this has been my prayer throughout that time, just knowing that looking for a job during the pandemic is already hard. Looking at a job alone is already hard, let alone is in during the pandemic. So long story short, that God answered my prayer by providing me with this new job that has they have started last December, which is last year. So I got a new job, everything seems fine, but the fun only just begins there. So since February and March, my company has had a COVID outbreak, so we have like probably around 200 cases by the end of March. It was just increased exponentially. I praise the Lord throughout that whole time. Even though there's like a few of close cases, and the colleague sitting my next to my table, he had positive, and one of my members also, he had positive, which I kind of had close contact, and also my dad's company also have his own case, so everything was like very very chaos. But praise the Lord that he has been protecting me throughout that time, that I'm still healthy and alive, standing here sharing my testimony. And so for my final work in the progress is revealed in my life through Equip Group this year. So I invited a friend of mine who's a non-Christian to join Christianity Explored, one of the Equip Groups that we had, and he agreed. So I've known him for 3 years from now, and through our interaction, I can see how God is working in him throughout this time, and even though he has not yet received Christ. And I praise God for continuously providing me opportunities to talk to him about my faith and share the gospel with him. And I'm still praying for him that one day God will open up his heart to believe. So these are just among the many things that God has revealed his presence in my life over the year, and I hope you too will give thanks to God for what he has done for you.
Church, we have reached almost the end of the service. I have just a few announcements to make, and then we're going to sing a song together, and then we're going to have commissioning, and then after that lunch together. So a few announcements is that offering, we do collect offering. The details of the bank transfer is on the screen, as you can see. I would also like to say that we have two things regarding offering. One is that the flood relief, the call to help raise funds for the flood relief last week, we have managed to raise 8,500 ringgit, and we have given that all to Mercy Malaysia on 24th of December. And another thing that is ongoing is that we would like to raise funds for Gospel City Network. And Gospel City Network is an organization that exists to help plant churches in Malaysia and throughout Asia. And we are still having ongoing funds raising for that. So if you would like to help in that and to raise funds for that, continue to just bank it into the GCC account and then mark it with EYO, which is N, no, no, is it EYO? EYO? E-O-Y, sorry, end of year. Okay, so we will make a tally at the end of the year. Okay, and next is a Sunday afternoon at 5 p.m. We usually have a prayer meeting via Zoom, which is only about half an hour. That is on recess at the moment until next year. So just to let you know that there is, there's prayers meeting weekly. Next is Thursday night. We will have a time of devotion and prayer as well, led by one of our elders, and that is also via Zoom. And if you're interested, then we will share the link in our WhatsApp chat group. You can see all the different QR code there. And if you would like to know regularly about what's happening in GCC, then I invite you to join the WhatsApp group. You can see there. If you're a new visitor, we would really like it if you would fill in the form. Again, the code is there, and someone will contact you. The other two is you can see a GCC care there. That is for anyone who feels that they need physical help or any other kind of help. Just fill in the form, and then somebody from the Mercy team will be checking the form and will contact you and help you. And also, you will see the equip group. What we are currently doing is that we're all meeting in different equip groups, and you can see the details of the different equip groups there. Currently, we are all meeting via Zoom. If you have not joined any equip group, or if you're interested, then you know, just fill in that form, and someone, one of the leaders, whichever days that you choose, one of the leaders will contact you. Okay, it's not actually newcomers lunch, it's lunch for everybody today. So since it's Christmas time, we have lunch provided for everyone. I will give you the logistics later, but you know, please stay back if you do not have anything planned. Later after this, I will let you know what's happening, where we're going and all that. Okay, so thank you very much.
All right, we want to sing one last song. We want to wish everybody a Merry Christmas. So can I invite all y'all to stand? We'll sing a last carol.
Receive.
Okay, so for commissioning this week, again, I'll be using Acts chapter 4, verse 11 to 12. Let me read it. This Jesus is a stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. You are commissioned.